Okay, I think I'm on, correct? It looks like I'm on.
We hear you, Steve, loud and clear.
Okie dokie, here we go then. Well, welcoming everybody to day two, and I'm really enjoying this, although it is very bizarre talking to myself in a computer screen when I'm used to having an audience out there laughing and talking back to me and the interaction. But we're making this work and grateful for the opportunity to do it. I really enjoy talking about all these topics. They're just kind of second nature to me. And I notice in the background there, you have the San Damiano cross, and that's what I wear everywhere I go. It is the whole Gospel of John in one icon image. And I wear it because people stop and say, that's beautiful. And it gives me a chance to tell people about Jesus. That's why I wear it. Almost every day in public, I get a chance to talk to someone because they comment on this cross. Well, we don't have a lot of time. I have 2 hours to talk about Mary. We did the first half yesterday. We really didn't get halfway. So we're going to have to go fast in this hour. I have actually done talks on Mary over 4 hours before because there's so much there and to unpack her whole life, and it's just so rich. But we're fitting it into 2 hours. So yesterday we started out with the Old Testament preparation for Mary, the prophecies, the prefigurations. We'll hit a bunch of those more today. We also talked about her birth, which is not in the New Testament, but is in the document called the Proto-Evangelium of James. And I'm going to mention that again today as we go along. We talked about her being the young girl and met by the angel with a great announcement. And we went to Ein Kerem, which was visitation, where Mary had the sang the Magnificat, and also that's where we discussed about her being the Ark of the New Covenant. So that'll come up again later today too. What I want to do now is she walks all the way back from Ein Kerem, that's a subdivision of Jerusalem where her relative Elizabeth lived, pure Aaronic priesthood, remember, pure blood. And she's now walking back to Nazareth, another 100-mile journey. 3 months pregnant, now she's walking 100 miles back. You know, as a crow flies, it might only be 80 miles, but they had to meander around, so I'm sure it was at least a 4 or 5 day walk. How many of you, if I'd say, well, we're going to walk from Ein Kerem or Jerusalem up to Nazareth, and that's about 100 miles, how long would it take us to walk? The general calculations from ancient times is that caravans, and that's usually how people traveled for safety's sake, safety in numbers, or with families and animals, especially in groups, it would be about 20 miles a day. I think probably Jesus and his disciples could cover a bit more. But at that rate, it would take them at least 5 days to walk that far. If Mary is nothing else, she is a tough little Jewish girl. This is why I said yesterday, the real girl. She was a tough girl. There's not a lot of girls that could do that today. And it's not even mentioned. She just went to visit her relative Elizabeth. Doesn't tell you she had to walk 100 miles to go visit her and then 100 miles back. Now she's back in Nazareth, and the pregnancy is progressing along to the point where she's now 9 months pregnant, and there is a census called from Rome, and Joseph is from the city of Bethlehem. That's where his ancestors are from the area of Judah, the tribe of Judah. So they pack up their little suitcase, whatever it was, and they head back down to Jerusalem at that point. And Bethlehem is 5 miles beyond Jerusalem. I have many times run back and forth between the birthplace of Christ, the Church of Nativity, to the checkpoint, back into Jerusalem to the tomb. And then I stopped running there, and I called that my womb to tomb run. And I used to do that a lot because it would be a great way to get exercise and explore and meditate on these things as I'm running through the land where they walked. So Mary's now on her way back to Bethlehem, which is, like I said, 4 or 5 miles south of Jerusalem. And so she's got another 100 miles to go. Now that is a difficult journey in the best of situations, but not real pleasant when you're 9 months pregnant. When I was doing my movie on Mary, I should show you this. I think I mentioned it yesterday. This is a movie I made on Mary My wife and I filmed this with my filming crew. It took us 3 weeks of filming in three countries. We went everywhere Mary went. And the things I'm doing now in this movie, I do on location so you can see the sites. And there's also a very comprehensive study guide that comes along with us. I also have one like this on Abraham, Moses, David and Solomon, Elijah and Elisha, Mary, one on Jesus, Paul, Peter, and the Apostolic Fathers. It's been a 20-year project. And I have one more to go, Doctors of the Church. But when I made this movie, I wanted people to see what it was like to ride a donkey through the wilderness areas, which is probably the way they went along, my guess is along the Jordan River, which is the lowest place on the face of the earth, 1,250 feet below sea level. And then they'd cut up and start going west up into the mountains of Jerusalem and Bethlehem. And I got on that donkey, and the first thing that donkey did was turn around and bit me on the leg. Now, I was raised with horses. I know how to ride horses, but donkeys are very evil creatures in my mind. And you get on a donkey, you don't know what he's going to do. First, he turned around and tried to bite me. Then he started bucking, thought he could get me off. Then the boy says, no, I show you how. And he got on and took a stick, and he showed me how you hit the donkey on the head. And you, if you want him to go right, you hit him on the on that side of the head. Now, the other way, you hit him so he knows where to go. And he stops to try to eat bushes along the way. And you, my point, of course, is this, that would it be better for Mary to walk or ride that evil beast called a donkey? I don't know. My wife said she didn't think she'd want to ride a donkey if she was 9 months pregnant, going 100 miles to Bethlehem to give birth to a baby. These were tough ladies back then. She was a tough little 15-year-old, 16-year-old girl. I want to emphasize the fact, because we don't think of Mary that way. We think of her as being so dainty and gentle woman, and she was really a very tough young lady doing all of this walking back and forth. So she's now on her way to Bethlehem. Now, as they're going, I want to bring out, we don't understand all the sorrows that Mary feels and she experiences along the way. We talked yesterday about how at the Annunciation, when she said yes, I think it was a sorrowful, nerve-wracking decision because of the social situation, because it was a stoning offense for a girl to get pregnant out of wedlock. And that's what Mary was. Even Joseph was concerned about it and was going to divorce her before they came together as a couple. And this also, then there was a time in Cana, we'll get to that in a bit, where she said goodbye to Jesus in a way. But at this moment, I think it was also a moment of sorrow and maybe even of consternation for Joseph, because the road they're walking on between Jerusalem, it's actually between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, it's called the Hebron Road. It's still there today. When we leave our hotel in Jerusalem, we go down the Hebron Road 5 miles and then pull into Bethlehem. And if you're going to go further to where Abraham lived, to Hebron, you got another 15 miles to go south. And if you want to go even further to where Abraham lived at the end of his life, you go, it's 50 miles total down to Beersheba. So as they're coming along that Hebron Road, coming into the entrance of Bethlehem, do you know what's there on the right-hand side of the road? 2,000 years earlier than Jesus and Mary and Joseph, their patriarch, their great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, Joseph, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, their great-great-great-grandfather, Jacob, who was coming from the Samaritan area all the way down. He was passing through Jerusalem on his way to Bethlehem, going to pass through Bethlehem and go back down to Hebron and Beersheba, where they lived in the Negev desert. And along the way, it says when they came to the entrance of Bethlehem, his favorite wife, he had two wives and two concubines, Rachel gave birth to her second son named Benjamin. And it said there at the entrance of Bethlehem, Rachel died, and Jacob buried her on the side of the road. And when you go to Bethlehem today, if you come with me to Bethlehem and we drive in, I'll point out the synagogue that still marks the tomb of Rachel 4,000 years later. And in my movie on Mary, we take you inside that set, and it's very under heavy security because it's in part of the West Bank in Bethlehem. But just imagine Mary and Joseph. My point is this, they're coming along and Mary is 9 months pregnant, very ready to give birth to a child. And they come by and they look over to their right. And what do they see? They see the tomb of their matriarch, Rachel, who was coming in the same road Mary's coming down, and also 9 months pregnant, and she gives birth to a boy right there, and then she dies. And Joseph knows he doesn't have a place for Mary to stay. No sanitary place, no home for her to give birth to the baby. Don't think that he didn't look over there and said, oh dear God, please take care of my wife. Don't let what happened to Rachel happen to her. And you may say, oh, he didn't have to worry. They knew this was a special baby and everything was fine. They didn't have to worry about a thing. Oh, really? Then why did he get up in the middle of the night and an angel with a very urgent message, quick, Herod's trying to kill the baby. Get up, go now. Because they did have to protect that baby. They couldn't just assume that that baby was going to be fine no matter what happens. They had to take care of him like any other parents had to take care of a baby boy. And don't think Joseph wasn't concerned when him and Mary passed by the tomb of Rachel. That's something that you don't realize until you actually know the land and you run back and forth and stop and you meditate about all these things. And I run by and I say, oh my goodness, Joseph came down. He saw that. Oh my, I wonder what he thought when he went past this tomb. Well, anyway, too much time on one small topic. We get to Bethlehem now, and we have a fulfillment of Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Oh, you small Judah, small Bethlehem Ephrata, too small among the clans of Judah, but yet from you will come the great king. The prophecy of almost 600 years earlier is now coming true. This is being fulfilled. The great king is coming to Bethlehem because Joseph was of the tribe of Judah, the kingly tribe, by the way, and had to come back to pay the fine. Now, Mary, he can't find a place for Mary to give birth. And in the story that I told you, the Proto-Evangelium of James, we have very little about the birth of Jesus in the Gospels, that he did, there was no place in the inn, no place in, because if you realize, if all the people are coming that were of the lineage of David, were coming to the small town of Bethlehem, that's where the Micah 5, 2 is where we get the song, O little town of Bethlehem, that comes right out of Micah chapter 5, verse 2. And you must have, could have only imagined that there was a donkey traffic jam in the main intersection of Bethlehem. Because all these people are coming from all over Israel to do the census and to pay their tax. You can imagine all the donkeys and the people, and there was no hotels open for them at the time. And so they found a cave, actually a place where animals are born. And we know that as a hint in the Gospels, because it says that she placed him in a manger, which is a food dish for animals. So she was in a very unsanitary place. I've been in a lot of these caves because all the way outside of Bethlehem, as soon as you go outside of Bethlehem, you go into the Judean wilderness and it's desolate out there. And there's a lot of Bedouin families that live there, just like they have for thousands of years, living the same way in caves, and they live with their animals and with their flocks. And so you go into any of those caves out there, even if a cave, you find it on the side of the hill, you go there, you always find three things there. You find, first of all, the roof of the cave is all black from soot because of the fires for thousands of years of shepherds coming in there to keep their sheep at night. And there's a place where there's always a fire in the center. And then I always jokingly say there's a lot of things on the ground in there that look like raisins, but they're not raisins. This is where sheep and goats are. And this is the kind of unsanitary condition that Mary gave birth to the baby Jesus. And you might say, well, why didn't God give his son a much better reception? We sometimes think God doesn't take very good care of me. Why doesn't he give me a better living situation? Why doesn't he give me a little more money? Why do I? But then we look back at his own son was born in a very unsanitary conditions of a cave where animals are. And his mother wraps him she wraps him in swaddling clothes. That means they kind of bind them all up with their arms down so they can't move much. Babies have been wrapped like that all through the centuries. And then she puts him in a manger. And like I said yesterday in the Eucharist talk, how many mothers, the first thing they do is put their baby in a manger where animals eat? And I think that's because Mary was telling us that Jesus was going to become our food. Now, also another interesting thing is, why were the shepherds the first ones to hear about the birth of Jesus? Why not the upper echelon? Why not the rulers? Why not the priests and the Pharisees? This is the Jewish Messiah, after all. Why is it the lowly shepherds who were considered unclean because they spent weeks at a time out with the animals living on the ground and in caves? Well, I think that there's a reason why the shepherds were the first to know about Jesus' birth, because shepherds are always the first ones to know about the birth of a lamb. And Jesus is the Lamb of God. And so therefore the shepherds, it's appropriate, they're the first ones to know about his birth in a place where sheep are born, in these kind of caves. So anyway, Bethlehem is not the incarnation. Some people think that the incarnation, Jesus becoming flesh, took place in Bethlehem when he was born, but not so. We talked yesterday about how the incarnation took place in Nazareth. Everything started in Nazareth. The Word became flesh here. Without Nazareth, there would be no Bethlehem. Without Nazareth, there would be no Ein Kerem, no Jerusalem, none of those places that are associated with the life of Jesus, because it all began 9 months before the birth in Bethlehem. The incarnation took place in Nazareth. And that is a very pro-life argument, by the way, that human life begins at conception 9 months before that baby is born. Well, I want to leave Bethlehem because of time. And do they go back up to Nazareth? No. You want to know how tough this little Jewish girl is? She now has just given birth to a baby. She's taken him to the temple. Let's do this first. And there Simeon comes and says, Mary comes in with this beautiful little boy. She's 15 years old. Can you imagine? She's just glowing with pride for this little boy. And she knows it's a special little boy. This isn't just your average boy. This is the Son of God. And Joseph is proud too, to be the chosen father of Jesus. God, just think of God looking for the right man, and he chose Joseph, the chosen father. They're there now at the temple, and they're so proud of this little baby, and this old prophet named Simeon comes up and said, that child is going to be the sign of contradiction and the rise and fall of many in Israel, and a sword will pierce your soul also. That's one of the seven traditional sorrows of Mary in the devotion of the seven Dolorosas, the seven sorrows, is the words of Simeon. And she wouldn't know what that meant until we get to Calvary, which we'll do shortly. But Mary didn't get to go back home after the circumcision and after her dedication. After 40 days, she had to purify herself from ceremonially giving birth, and she had to what's called redeem her son. It was the 2 weeks' wages they had to give to the priest to, in a sense, buy back the firstborn from God. I'm not going to go into detail about that, but that all took place. And by the way, this is the first time Jesus shed his blood for us. At the circumcision, the blood flowed from Jesus. That was the first time. The second time he shed his blood that we know was in Gethsemane, when it says that blood came out of the capillaries and his pores and his head as he prayed in such agony. And then the third, so shedding of blood, was at the whipping and the beating and at the cross. So Jesus gave his blood for us first when he was only 8 days old at his circumcision. But Mary and Joseph, after this, were warned that Herod was out to kill the boy. And he was after all the boy under 2 years old. So they had to flee, and they went to Egypt. They had to go through the Sinai Desert, the Sinai Peninsula, to get to Egypt. There was a Jewish community living in Cairo at the time. So that was at least 250 miles. This was walked or ridden on a donkey. Either one is equally bad. And Joseph had to sweep his wife away, get her out of town quick to save the baby's life. And they went all the way through the Sinai, around the Mediterranean Sea, and down to Cairo of today, where there was a Jewish community. And in the story, in my movie on Mary, if you want to see the place where they lived in Cairo with the Jewish community, they still preserve that house, the Christians still, 2,000 years later. That is the cave, the place that's a grotto underground now, where the Holy Family lived. When there's an estimate of maybe 18 months in Egypt, nobody knows for sure. The Egyptians have a lot of very interesting traditions about this that we followed when we went there. Been to Egypt many, many times, and followed that tradition of the places that they said the Holy Family visited while they were there. But then they had to walk 250 miles back to Jerusalem, and then another 100 miles back up to Nazareth. See why I say the real girl, Mary, the tough Jewish girl? Because my goodness, who of us could have kept up with her and Joseph and the baby? Now, I want to get to Nazareth. Now we come to a very interesting time in Mary's life. And we can learn a lot about the Holy Family at this point and about Mary herself, because we call this the 30 silent years, the 30 years of quiet. They live in their cave in Nazareth. And if you came with me to the Holy Land, we would have first been in the Church of the Annunciation, which is where Mary lived as a girl and where the angel came with the announcement. And that's why the big Church of the Annunciation is over that cave. But if you just walk up the hill a little bit, the village was only no more than 2 acres in size. You walk up the hill a little bit, and there's another church there called the Church of St. Joseph. It's also called St. Joseph's Workshop. Underneath that church, there's a big cave. And from the very beginning, there was a belief that Mary and Joseph and Jesus lived in that cave. And if you want to see that cave, it's also in my movie, because they won't let anybody down there. But I was able to get permission, and we went down and filmed the house where the Holy Family lived for those 30 silent years until Jesus began his earthly ministry. When I'm in Israel and I'm at Nazareth for this, right before I take everybody in to see that cave, I give a half an hour talk called A Day in the Life of the Holy Family. What was it like to wake up in the morning, live a day with them, and then fall asleep on the mats at night? And we do a talk. I give an hour talk about that too. We're only going to be able to squeeze in about 5 minutes here. And so they have the 30 silent years. And I like to ask people, there was 25 caves living in Nazareth where the families lived. The archaeologists have found about 25 caves. And when we talk about the house, Holy House of Loreto, I don't have time to go into a lot of that. But people say, well, if they lived in caves, then what's the Holy House of Loreto? Well, assuming that the Holy House of Loreto is authentic, and I'm not debating or doubting that at all, it would be in when you had a cave, the father of the cave or the husband would build a facade to the cave. There'd be like a big entrance. You see the caves in Bethlehem today, they're big openings. But they would build a front to them. Even today, when you go out and see the Bedouins, they have fronts built over their caves and places where their animals can go in and out because they live with their animals in the cave. And they build a facade with a door to go into the cave. And so my contention would be that the Holy House of Loreto is not the whole house that's there. There you can see where the stones that came from Nazareth are. They're the lower level, an L-shaped part. And that would have been, if anything, that would be the facade of their cave, which would have been their house that had been transported to Italy. Now, I like to ask people, and especially when I have young people in our group, and we always have young people in the group, especially in December, we go over Christmas break. It's called a family Holy Land pilgrimage, where families come and bring their kids. Best way to keep them Catholic in the world is to bring them there and let them be exposed to that land. It has a sacramental impact on people. And I like to ask people, okay, what is the first thing in the morning? The Holy Family wakes up, their alarm clock goes off, and their alarm clock would have been a rooster. And they wake up. What's the very first thing the Holy Family did? Everybody says, they prayed. And I smile and said, is that the first thing you do every morning when you wake up? And everybody thinks for a moment and goes, well, no, we go to the bathroom. And you don't think the Holy Family did that? Somehow we have this attitude that the Holy Family floated 3 feet off the ground, that they weren't really human, that somehow they were kind of a mixed half angelic, and they never had to do things like go to the bathroom or such earthly mundane things. But that's the first thing they had to do. Then I asked the question is, where do you go to the bathroom if you live in a cave with no plumbing, no toilets, no air conditioning, refrigerators, electricity, running water? Where do you go to the bathroom? Well, I'd usually tell them, I'll leave that up to your imagination. But we do know that in the Old Testament, that there was a passage about cleanliness where you had to build latrines and cover things up. So this was very rustic. The Holy Family did not live like we do. The Holy Family lived very primitive. We jokingly say they were the first Flintstones, living in caves, very rustic life. And I think it's important for us to see that about the Holy Family, because it doesn't in any way degrade them or denigrate them or we think less of them. I think it causes me to love them more and to be more impressed with them and to would love nothing more than to go back and live a week with them and to see even more what it was like. This is what I really like to use my imagination when I'm there and walk in their paths and see where they lived and just put myself back 2,000 years ago. Well, after they took care of that business. Then they would come back and then they would pray. And the Jews had regular prayers, just like the sisters have prayers that they pray every morning and every noon and every night. And it's the prayers of the church all the way around the world. We pray those prayers. And it's the same for the Jewish people. They have also prayers that they prayed, and they would chant those prayers. And they would recite the same prayers. All the Jews around the world do the same thing. Even to this day, that's the case. And so they lived for these 30 years. And Joseph and Jesus would get up in the morning and have to go to work. And just briefly on that is, where would they go to work? They live in a village with 25 caves. And anyone who has a business or any salesperson knows that in order to have business, you have to have a customer base. And if you only have 25 caves, that's not where you can't make any money that way. And a carpenter is the Greek word tekton. It doesn't mean what we think of as a carpenter. A carpenter then would be, it's the definition of tekton is one who works with hard materials. Simple as that. They're a day laborer. They work with their hands, with rocks, with metal, with wood, whatever. They're craftsmen. They're day laborers. Now, in the case of Joseph and Jesus, I think when they woke up, Mary first lit the candle, and in the cave, when I've been down there, you can see there's little niches in the side, and they still have all the soot because there were little oil lamps, pottery lamps with oil and a wick, and she would light those three or four places around. It would give a nice warm glow. She'd kick up the coals in the fire because the cave had a fire and a hole in top, just like a chimney, and the smoke would go up, and she would kick up the coals and make a simple breakfast. What did they eat? Well, maybe they ate simple things like lentils and beans and made soups and porridges. We know that Jacob and Esau, for example, Esau sold his birthright for a pot of red porridge, red lentil soup. And they ate simply. They didn't eat a lot of meat, but they would eat simple things like fruits and vegetables and nuts. They did have eggs because we know Jesus said, how often is a mother hen when I would gather you as my chicks? So there was such a thing as eggs and chicken, but it was a very simple and a very healthy diet that they ate. And they would drink water that they got from the well 15 minutes away. They would have some of that for drinking. Well, then Joseph and Jesus would go to work. Where did they go to work? Well, I have the contention, and I think most historians would agree with me, biblical historians, that Jesus and Joseph walked about 1 hour to a city called Zippori in Hebrew, or Sepphoris. The way we see it on our maps is Sepphoris. And this was a booming construction site. This was being a city being built by the emperor in Rome. And it was going to be a great city and a capital city. And so they were drawing labor, skilled and unskilled labor from all around the area to come to work. Well, Joseph and Jesus are carpenters or workers with their hands. And I think what they did, because when you go to Nazareth, you see, and to Sepphoris, I just took a group to Sepphoris in February of this year. It was our last pilgrimage before all this virus thing happened. And we showed them that everything was built out of rock. And those stones that they're built are all cubes. And God doesn't make cubes like that. That's made by men. I think when Joseph and Jesus walked there, and I know pretty much the way they walked because I've run from their cave in Nazareth, and I've run over the hillside and down to Sepphoris, went around there, and then I ran back again. It took me a half an hour to run there. So I assume that they're walking. It would take about an hour. So they'd get up before the sun, and they'd be walking as the sun rose on their way to work. And then I would like to ask myself when I was running along, what were Jesus and Joseph talking about as they went on their way? What did they talk about each day for an hour together? Or did they walk with the other men of Nazareth who were most certainly also many of them going to work there? Did they joke around and have a jovial time? Or did Jesus and Joseph? I think these guys were a lot of fun to be with. I don't think Joseph and Jesus were somber. I think that they were the best guys in the group, and people loved being with them. My thinking is that God created us in his image, and we have a sense of humor and fun about us, and I think that Jesus would quite as well. And I could do another whole talk on it because I find places in the Gospels where I see the humor of Jesus, and I think where he just kind of really guffawed and laughed with all of his guys every once in a while. They'd arrive at work, and I think they got assigned to chisel all these rocks or to cut rocks out of the quarry, because even in Nazareth today is all this Jerusalem limestone that they build with. They don't have a lot of trees. Everything is made out of stone. And so I see Jesus and Joseph all day, chink, 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 with a hammer, chipping away at rocks. They get a half an hour for a lunch break in the heat, and it can be 110 degrees in Nazareth. I've been there when it's very hot. We don't see or think of Joseph as being the soft man that we often see him. I don't like statues where he's shown as real effeminate. I like the ones that show him very masculine, and there aren't a lot of them. I saw the statue in the chapel here, and I like that one. And I like, there's some even more. I've seen pictures of very rugged. And there's a painting by a French convert named Tissot, who is that's my favorite painting. I should have had a picture of it for you. But it's Joseph in bare feet, rugged, standing with the rocks and the wood that he's working with. And after they worked all day, they would come home again that hour walk, and Mary would be prepared. She'd see him coming over the hill, and Mary would rush back in and say, "Oh, my guys are coming home." And she'd get the fire going again, and she'd get the mats laid out, and she'd have dinner ready for them, and their clothes were all washed for the next day. And they came in, and they were exhausted and covered with sweat and dust, and they'd have to clean off the best they could. She'd give them dinner, and then they would pray their prayers together, and then they would fall asleep on the mats, only to start over again the next day. Except for the seventh day, that was the Sabbath, that was reserved for God, and they didn't work on that day. Now, I used to think to myself, what a waste of time. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph living in that cave together for 30 silent years. What a waste of time. What more? Jesus could have gone out and healed more people. Jesus could have written a couple books for the New Testament, or we could have had, instead of 27, we could have had 33 and had 6 books that Jesus wrote. How cool would that be? But they just lived that silent life. Nobody knew who Jesus was. In fact, when he finally announced it at 30 years old, they were so angry at him, they were ready to throw him off a cliff. Remember? Who are you? We know who you are. You're the carpenter's son. What do you mean you're telling us you're the light that comes from up to the land of the Gentile? What do you mean you're the one that's fulfilling these prophecies of Isaiah? And they tried to kill him. So this whole time, they knew he was a good guy, but they didn't know who he was or what his purpose was in life. Mary had kept kind of mum about that. That was a family secret, I think, pretty much along the way. And so then the catechism says that silent life of the Holy Family was important because it taught us 3 things. Number one, it taught us that the importance of being quiet, of silence before God. The sisters know about this. Guys like me don't. We live busy lives. We're talking all the time, noisy, busy, active. But the Holy Family teaches us, wait a minute, there's time to be quiet before God. Those silent years were developing. They were teaching us the necessity of silence before God. The second thing they taught us was the dignity of family life, of families living together, parents and children, and how important that is to do the mundane things of life. I like to ask the girls when we're there, what is more spiritual, to pray the rosary or to change a dirty diaper? And believe me, Jesus had dirty diapers. We don't think of that either. What's more spiritual? Well, if you see the baby in the dirty diapers and he's getting a rash and starting to cry, and you say, "I'm sorry, baby, but I have to go pray because I have to take care of my spiritual obligations first. And when I'm done praying the rosary and my other prayers, I'll come back and take care of you." That's not spiritual at all. Mother Teresa would say, "No, no, no." And so would Mary. The most spiritual thing you can do at any moment in life is to do exactly what God wants you to be doing at that particular moment in life. And at this moment, the most spiritual thing you can do is to change that baby's diaper and then take the baby with you to go pray. But we get the idea sometimes that there are spiritual and mundane practices in life. But the most spiritual thing, remember, is that always to doing what God wants us to do at that particular moment. And the family, living that quiet family, that teaches us the dignity of the family. But third, it teaches us the dignity of work. We were made to work before the fall in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve were to till the garden and to take care of it. And I think to expand the boundaries of the garden to cover eventually the whole earth. That was their job, to work and to take care of and to manage, be stewards of that garden and all of the animals God gave them. It was only after sin that now that work became laborious and painful. And it says that now there were thorns and thistles and it made it different. But so we see the need for quiet before God, the dignity of family life, and the dignity of work. Those are things we can learn from the Holy Family in those 30 years. Somewhere in that time, Mary had another sorrow that we don't think about, and that's that Joseph died. Now, there are two traditions. One is that Joseph was an older man, and that one that Joseph was a younger man. The oldest tradition in the church, by the way, is that Joseph was a widower. He was an older man and a widower who had other children prior to with another wife. And I know there's some people that get very upset when I say that, but I'm only telling you the facts that the early church did believe this. And if you want to see it, you can read that again in the Proto-Evangelium of James, which was a second century document. And it's, again, the document where we get the names Joachim and Anna. It's this document I told you about yesterday. It's the one where we learned that Mary was dedicated to the temple and a lot of the facts that we pretty much take for granted as Catholics, but they're not in the Bible, but they came from this document. And this document presents Joseph as an older man who gave had other children and his wife died. And then the angel came and had all of the men put sticks in the ground, and the one that blossomed with a lily was the one that was chosen to be the husband of Joseph, and it was, I mean, the husband of Mary, and that was Joseph. Now, that makes a lot of sense in one way, because we hear about in scriptures the brothers of our Lord, and if Joseph was a younger man, then we consider those to be his cousins or his kin. But if Joseph had other sons prior to Mary, and then his wife died, those brothers and sisters of our Lord would have been his older step brothers and sisters. Now, I don't have time to go through all that. I'm just telling you that that is still the view held by the Eastern Church today. If you go to Russia and the Greek Orthodox and the ancient churches and traditions in Israel and these lands, they still hold that Joseph was an older man who was a widower, and that Mary was very young. The Western church tends to hold to Joseph being a younger man, but the church has never defined it, and there is no official teaching one way or the other. Now, Joseph dies somewhere along the line, and maybe somewhere in the middle. We know it was after Jesus was 12 years old, because we know that Jesus stayed back at the temple at 12 years old, and Joseph was there. And this also shows that Mary didn't know everything. She didn't understand everything. When Jesus stayed back, they were looking for him. I can sense the desperation, because when I raised our kids, it wasn't even as dangerous as it is these days. But when we were in a grocery store and all of a sudden I didn't see one of my kids, we'd panic. We'd go running around looking for him. Imagine you're halfway back to a day into the journey back to Nazareth, and you say to men and women traveled separately. Jesus was about 12 years old, so the younger boys always stayed at their moms. But when they got to be 12, 13, then they started traveling with the men. So at this point, Jesus is right in the middle. That's why this is a problem. And they get to their first stop at night on this journey back home, and Joseph says, "Where's Jesus?" And Mary said, "I thought he was with you." "No, I thought he was with you." "Oh my goodness, we've lost the Son of God." Can you imagine losing the Son of God? So they turn around and they go back and they find him there. And then Mary says, "Why did you do this to your father and I?" She's trying to figure this out. Why? What happened? Why did you do this to your father and I? Which shows it's correct to call Joseph the father of Jesus, as long as we're clear that it's not a biological father, it's an adoptive or legal father. But Mary said, "Why did you do this to your father and I?" Joseph was a chosen one and such a special man. But somewhere after 12 years old and before 30 years old, Joseph dies, because we never hear about him again. Joseph never says one word in the Gospels. We never hear a word from Joseph. We only see one adjective about him when all the talking of Joseph is done. I do a whole hour talk just on Joseph, by the way. And there's only one adjective in the Gospels referring to Joseph, and it is he is a righteous or a just man. That was the only adjective about him. Although we see the angel come to Mary, and Mary talks to the angel, and the angel tells her what to do. When the angel comes to Joseph, he didn't say anything. He just gets up and does what the angel says to do. So we know there's a lot of adjectives that relate to him, like holy and righteous and obedient and quick-witted and a bunch of others we could come up with as well. anyway, we got to get moving because this is, the time is running out and we got to get to all the way with Mary, all the way to heaven. And we got a ways to go here. So this is another death of a sorrow of Mary, though, when Joseph dies. Now, they go to Cana. The 30 years are over. You can imagine all these years, Jesus, little three-year-old, mommy, mommy, wait for me, as they're running off to get the water at the well. You know, you imagine these things while you're there. But now he's 30 years old, and there's a wedding in Cana, which is also about an hour's walk away because I've run to Cana and back, and there was a wedding there. Weddings, by the way, in Israel take 7 days, not like ours. I have three daughters and a son, and it was always wore us out. We had the rehearsal dinner, then we got up the next day and we had the wedding, and then they had the reception dinner and took pictures, and then they went off on their honeymoon, and 24 hours later we crashed and said, oh, that was exhausting. Well, imagine weddings that take 7 days, and I've been a part of weddings with our friends in Nazareth, two of them actually, and I know what it's like to go through these wonderful weddings. And that's another whole talk in and of itself of showing how the weddings there help us to understand this passage in John chapter 2 and Mary and her place. But Mary was an intercessor. She was obviously a friend of the family. She saw that they didn't have enough wine, which was a disaster because people came from all over and expected to be taken care of. And there's the old saying that Jews never could have fun at a wedding without wine. And if you don't have wine, that was just a big, big problem. So she comes in. She calls Jesus from out, like I said, yeah, they calls Jesus from out of the men's area and says, they have no wine. And he says, woman, what does that have to do with you and I? My hour has not come. That meaning my hour has not yet come. It's not yet time for me to do my first miracle and expose who I really am. Because as soon as I do that miracle, mom, all of a sudden the divinity is going to show through my pores. Everybody's going to say, oh, he's not just a carpenter. He is a miracle worker. He's the Messiah. And everything is going to change, mom. And I'm not going to be able to go to work at Sepphoris anymore. I won't be staying with you overnight in the cave, sleeping on our mats together and having breakfast together and praying together. And every day you see me coming over the top of the hill and you run in and make dinner for me. That's all going to stop, mom. My hour has not yet come. And Mary said, yes, it has. She's the one who told Jesus when to start his earthly ministry. And the way this all played out is she said, Jesus, come here. They have no wine. Jesus argues with her a little bit. She doesn't even pay any attention to him. Doesn't even talk to him anymore. She says to the servants, do whatever he tells you. And she turns around and walks back over to the women's section. She knew that Jesus would do what he told her to do. In that land, the women, the wives are the most powerful. They say that if the father dies, it's a disaster. If the mother dies, it's an ultimate disaster. The mothers control the families. They say, oh, you in the West, you think the women have to vote. The women have to get involved. They have to become feminists. They say, we don't have to do any of that here. And we're still in more control than anybody else. Remember the movie, My Big Fat Greek Wedding? And the women were all together. And this is what very much what Mary would think. They said, the men, they say they are the head. Okay, they can be the head. But the woman, she be the neck. And the neck tells the head which way to turn. And this is the way it is with women in the Middle East. So she is the one who tells Jesus when his earthly ministry is to begin. Jesus obeys her. He tells those men to fill those stone jars. Those were 6 stone jars of water. When I'm in Cana, I do a whole half hour talk on this too, but just really quickly, 6 is the imperfect number. 7 is the perfect number, the number of God, 7 days of the week, 7 sacraments, 7 archangels. 7 is the perfect number. 6 is one short of perfect. It's incomplete. And there's only 6 stone jars there. And they are with water for cleansing only the outward things like hands and feet and pots and pans. And they're only there for the Jews. But at the end of the Gospel of John, we see Jesus on the cross with water coming out of his side. He becomes the 7th jar. Now there's 7 jars. And it's not just for cleansing the Jews, but for the whole world. And not just for pots and pans, but inside for our hearts. So there's so much typology and so much going on in the Bible that it just, we could spend hours and hours talking about all the parallels between all these things. But anyway, we got to get moving on. So now in Cana, when Mary says, do whatever he tells you and walks away, I'm convinced she had tears in her eyes because what she just said is, goodbye, son. I'm now saying goodbye to you because I'm giving you back to your heavenly father to serve him. And I know you're not going to be coming back and I'm not going to see you coming over the hill anymore at the end of the day. because I'm giving you now to go out and serve your Heavenly Father. And I have tears in my eyes, son, because I'm saying goodbye. I'll miss you. And she no longer had the exclusivity of the relationship with her son. Who did she give him to? Her Heavenly Father, yes. But who else? She gave him to us. And from that moment, Mary pretty much watched from afar with the holy women. And Jesus was out in his ministry and took it all the way to the cross, where she was with him there in a very special way. So Cana, Mary was an intercessor then, and she's still an intercessor today. Now I want to zoom through, because we only have 15 minutes left, which is nowhere near enough time, but we'll do it. We go on the Via Dolorosa, on the Way of Sorrows, and it says the holy women, Jesus met them in the Gospels. It doesn't say that he met his mother. That is a station of the cross that's not mentioned in Scripture, but can you not doubt for 1 minute that Mary was there with the holy women? And I remember this, the movie of Mel Gibson, when Jesus falls carrying the cross, and Mary in slow motion runs to him and falls down to him to want to help and comfort him, but they push her away. And he just looks through his bloody, bruised, busted up face and says, Mother, I make all things new. That movie, then Mel Gibson flashes back to when Jesus was a little boy and he's running down the pathway towards Mary, and he trips and he falls and he goes, oh, and Mary comes running and falls down by Jesus and comforts him and picks him up and takes care of his wound. And she tries to do that now when he's carrying the cross, but they just push her away. Get away, woman. They won't let her get near him. But the whole thing in Jerusalem now is the Via Dolorosa, and at the cross, there's so much to say here, but at the cross, we are in a garden. The interesting thing is that John makes a very special point in his gospel. Like I said, I have a 450-page book on John where I go through all of this. And John makes us know that the Garden of Gethsemane, that's where the sin fell on Jesus. It has to be in a garden. Because why? Because the fall took place in the garden. And Jesus, he's rewinding everything like a video. He's starting over again with a new humanity. It has to be in a garden. He's the new Adam who brings about redemption after the old Adam at the tree of life brought about death. The new Adam at the tree of death brings about life. It's a reversal. And the garden, everything had the end of Jesus's passion. Everything had to be in a garden. The Garden of Gethsemane is where the sins of the world came down. The most painful moment, I think, for Jesus of the whole passion. And then the cross and the tomb, John tells us that those are in a garden as well. You don't think of a cross or like a electric chair or a gallows with a rope being in a garden, but that's what John tells us. It's in a garden outside the city walls of Jerusalem. And in case you miss it, John makes sure that he makes the point just to make it double solid, is that when Mary Magdalene came and she mistook Jesus for what? A gardener. Because this was important that you know it's a garden, because of the tree of death is now reversing what happened at the tree of life in the garden. It's bringing the life back. And if you think about it, Adam and Eve were naked in their innocence and had to leave clothed. Jesus came into the garden clothed and had to be stripped naked to restore that innocence in a garden at another tree. So this is very important, this whole idea of the gardens and these parallels that are between Old and New Testament that just play back and forth with each other. Mary, she's at the foot of the cross. There's a place in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre where I always show my group. There's a white disc in the floor, and in that white disc, it's in Armenian. But this is the place where the holy women stood and looked up at Calvary, and Calvary's just up there. So they were standing. That's where they stood and watched. But Mary even got closer, and she was at the foot of the cross, and she watched her son die. You talk about sorrow. Watching your son die. I had a very uncomfortable experience in March. My older sister, she was 80 years old. My older sister died rather suddenly. And I had the job to go the next day and tell my 98 and a half year old mother that your daughter just died. There's a saying that there's no grief or sorrow more than for a parent to watch their child die before they do. It's against nature. The old is supposed to give birth to the new, and then the old dies, and then the young grows, and there's the cycle. But that's the worst thing ever for a parent, to watch their child die. And I had to go sit with my 98-year-old mom and watch her just slouch into the chair when I said, your only daughter just died. And can you imagine Mary at the foot of the cross, seeing her son treated that way, knowing of his innocence, knowing of his beauty and of his nobility and of his excellence and of his care and love, even for those who are torturing him. And yet she gave him up and watched him die. And there in Calvary, in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, right next to the cross where the cross stood, and we have our people reach down and touch the rock that's under the altar. And I say that if you reached and touched that rock 2,000 years ago, your hands would come up sticky with his blood. And right next to that, there's a glass case of Mary. And it's a beautiful one. It's the artist was exceptional because the face is so real and the eyes show both fear and pain, but confidence at the same time. It's how he did it. I have no idea, but there is a huge sword going right into her chest. And you look at her and her eyes are open wide and she's got the sword is right in her chest. And that's where the moment has come, and now she understands what Simeon the prophet meant when he said, a sword will pierce your soul as well. Well, we have to leave Jerusalem, even though there's much to say there. One interesting point is that Jesus said to Mary in his gasping, one of his last seven words is while he's in agony, woman, your son, your mother. Why does he call Mary woman? Both at the beginning of the gospel, he calls her woman, and at the end of the gospel, he calls her woman. And I think it's to direct your mind back to the book of Genesis 3:15, where it said, there will be a woman, and there will be enmity between you and the woman in your seed. Jesus is drawing your attention back to the garden again. Woman, he says, from the tree of in the garden of Gethsemane, the garden of Calvary. And so Mary watches her son die. Now, I want to take you next to the day of the ascension into heaven. Jesus raises from the dead. Excuse me. And I'm convinced that his mother is the one who wrapped him in his shroud. Those who have studied it said it was so perfectly and gently wrapped around every bit of his body that only a mother could have done that. And I think that Mary was the one who wrapped him in his swaddling clothes at the first moment of his earthly life. And she's the one that wrapped him in the shroud at the last moment of his life. And if you think about it, a man named Joseph gave Jesus a cave in which to be born. And a man named Joseph gave Jesus a cave in which to be buried, Joseph of Arimathea. Now we have the ascension into heaven, and Jesus goes up and he tells his disciples to go to the upper room and to pray, and they left and they went for 9 days praying, and Mary was with them. And that's where we get the Catholic novena. We have the 9 days of prayer. Why? Because Jesus went up into heaven, tells them to go back and pray. They pray for 9 days, and on the 10th day, the Holy Spirit comes. So that 9 days has been very special to Catholics ever since, where we have the novena. Now, it says that Mary was in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. Why is that important to know Mary's in the upper room? It doesn't always tell us where Mary is. We know Mary is a lot of times with Jesus, but it doesn't always tell us that. But the Luke in his book of Acts tells us that Mary was there in the upper room. Why is that important? Because I think that the Jews were afraid of God because the only thing they knew about fire coming down on a mountain and this, they knew that fire was going to come down was Mount Sinai. See again how the Old Testament is so important. And when the fire came down on the mountain, the Israelites were so afraid. It said they ran and they hid and they said to Moses, don't you ever let God speak to us again. From now on, you go talk to God and don't you ever let God speak to God. He's too scary. He's too terrifying. And I think the people in these upper room, that's what's in their mind. They're up on Mount Zion now and the fire is going to come down on them, and they're thinking of the first Pentecost because this is the day of Pentecost, and the day the fire came down was the first Pentecost at Mount Sinai. Oh, could talk for an hour and a half. But the fire came down, and Mary was there to say, guys, relax. I've already been overshadowed by God. I've already had the experience of God in my life. Don't worry. It's nothing to be afraid of. I think the second reason Mary is in the upper room because it's the day of Pentecost. And what is the day of Pentecost? What do we think of? Happy birthday to you. It's the birth of the church. And if the birth of the mystical church is going to be there, the mother has to be there for the birth. Mary is laboring in prayer with these guys, laboring in prayer to bring about the birth of the mystical body of Christ. And since Mary's the mother of the church, then we have to have the mother there for the birth of the church on Pentecost. Now, so many other things. Jesus gave, we're going to finish up here in 5-10 minutes. Jesus gave John to be the son of Mary because Mary did not have any other sons. In Jewish tradition, had Mary had other sons from her own body, they would have taken care of mom. But because Jesus is the only son, knowing his mother does not have any other biological sons, he gave her to his disciple John to take care of her. And it says from that moment on, Mary moved in and lived with John and Andrew. And I'd like to ask you a question. Imagine having Mary come to live with you. How would you change the way you do things and the way you live and the way you talk and the way you act if you knew that tomorrow Mary was going to move into your house for the rest of her life? I find that intimidating. And Andrew and John had Mary come in and live with them for the rest of her earthly life. Well, we know that John went away to Ephesus and he became the bishop of Ephesus, and Anne Catherine Emmerich, the Blessed, in a vision that she had from her bed in Germany, told monks where Mary's house was up on Nightingale Hill. And I take my groups to Ephesus. We go to Turkey and go to Ephesus, and we have Mass in Mary's house. And they found the foundations of this house and rebuilt it. And people love to go there now and go to Mary's house. While John was the bishop down below in this very wicked city, Mary and other holy women prayed in this house and lived there. Now, we know that in Acts chapter 15, I'm going fast here, Acts chapter 15 took place in 49 AD, and the disciples, the apostles, I should say, came back to Jerusalem for the first council to make determination whether Gentiles could become Christians without being circumcised first. And I believe that at that time, Mary would have been 70 years old. She came back to Jerusalem with John. The daughter of Zion returns to Mount Zion, and she decides there to die. John Paul II said that Mary died because she was immaculately conceived and never sinned. She wasn't subject to death, but she chose to associate herself with her son and to be the first fruits of the resurrection for us. And so she died on Mount Zion. There's a church there to this day. It's a German Benedictine church called the Church of the Dormition, the Abbey of the Dormition, and there's a statue of Mary laying there, ready to die, and there's a picture on the wall. We always see pictures of Mary holding Jesus, but this is a picture of Jesus holding Mary, ready to take her up to heaven. And there Mary died, and then she was buried at the foot of the Mount of Olives. There's a Greek Orthodox church, was once Catholic. It's called the Church of the Tomb of Mary, or also the Church of the Assumption of Mary. The difference between ascend and assumed. Ascend, you go up with your own rocket packs. Jesus didn't need anybody. He just went up. But assumed, Mary's not God. She doesn't have supernatural power. She's not God or divinity. So Jesus assumed, took her up to heaven. From that, that's also called the Church of the Assumption. And you go down there and you can actually see the place where tradition says Mary was buried. And they came back. Thomas was away. He came back with the other disciples the following day. They're going to prepare Mary's body better. When they got there, she was gone. Later, some people asked the Bishop of Jerusalem if they could have some relics of the Blessed Mother. And he said, I'm sorry, there are no relics. Mary was assumed into heaven. Was there any precedent for that? Yes. Enoch in the book of Genesis said Enoch walked with God and he was not, because God took him. And we know Elijah was also assumed into heaven. Even the book of Hebrews 11, which is the faith chapter, says that he was assumed into heaven. We already have two instances in the Old Testament where men were assumed into heaven, body and soul. So what's the big deal if Mary's taken up into heaven? So now I want to just quickly jump into Mary as the Queen of Heaven. She's the Ark of the Covenant. Remember I said this. I showed you this yesterday. Here's the Ark of the Covenant, and it has Revelation 11, 19, and 12, 1. Mary is that Ark of the Covenant. And it's interesting, in the Gospel of John, Revelation written by John, the way we read the Bible is, I'm going to go a couple minutes over. I hope that's okay. When we read the Bible, we read a chapter and then we close it and we go to bed, and we come back the next night and we read the next chapter and close it and go back to sleep. But the Bible was not written with chapters and verses. It was written as one continuous text. And in the book of Revelation, it says, "Behold, I looked up into the heaven and I saw the tabernacle, and the tabernacle was opened, and there was the Ark of the Covenant." See right here. That's why they have 11:19. That's the end of chapter 11. You read that he looked into heaven and he saw the Ark of the Covenant. And then it stops and next chapter starts. Chapter 12:1, "Behold, I saw the woman clothed with a sun, with a moon under her feet, and the crown of 12 stars on her head." That she was the one who gives birth to the one who would rule the world with a rod of iron. So if you don't stop there, you read it this way. "Behold, I looked into the heaven, I saw the tabernacle, and the door was open, and there was the Ark of the Covenant. Behold, I saw the woman clothed with the sun." Mary, the Queen of Heaven. So John sees Mary as the Ark of the Covenant already there. The Jews would be astounded. "What do you mean, the Ark of the Covenant? We haven't had the Ark of the Covenant for over 600 years. How can you see the Ark of the Covenant?" But it's not the Ark of the Old Covenant. John sees the Ark of the New Covenant, and he sees the Queen. Why the Queen? Because in Jewish times in Israel, the king always had a queen, but it was not his wife. Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines, 1,000 women. Solomon was a very busy man, but Solomon only had one mother. And that says that Bathsheba came into his throne room, and Solomon got up off his throne and he bowed to his mother. The word is prostrated himself. And then he sat back on his throne and had another throne built at his right hand. And it said from that moment on, his mother sat at his right hand and ruled in the kingdom with her. And the queen mother was the intercessor for the people. Ding, 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 ding. Does that ring a bell? Jesus is the best king of all. And what did Jewish kings do? Jewish kings do what all Jewish kings do. And what do the kings of Israel do? They raise their mothers up to be seated at their right hand to be their queen. And they rule in the kingdom with their son. Sometimes the son was just a young boy and his mother sat there. She was the queen who taught him how to be the king. And she was in charge of ruling the kingdom as her son grew up. This is what Mary is. She's been raised up, assumed into heaven. Why? Just like Solomon assumed his mother up and set her at his right hand, so Jesus, the best king of Israel ever, assumed his mother up and set her at his right hand. And we do not worship the ark, Mary. We venerate the ark. What we worship is the glory cloud, the Jesus, the vision of God above her. So when people say that you worship Mary, you worship, I'd say, no, let me give you a Bible study. The Jews venerated the Ark of the Covenant. They couldn't even touch it, or they dropped dead if they weren't purified correctly. That shows something about Mary's status. If she's the Ark of the New Testament, you treat it with great respect. Nobody touched the old Ark, only the priests, only the ones that were prepared. The high priest could touch that thing. So now we have Mary, she's the Ark of the New Covenant, but we still, just like the Jews, did not worship that box. They worshiped God above, the glory cloud of God above, the Shekinah glory above that Ark of the Covenant. We don't worship Mary either. We venerate the box, so to speak. We venerate and honor and love Mary, but we worship the glory cloud above her, which is Jesus in her arms. So we as Catholics love Mary, we honor Mary. There's so much more to say. She's the mother of the church. She's the queen of heaven. And I would say that Mary still has sorrows today. Even though she's in heaven, she still has sorrows. And she's revealed those in some of her apparitions. She has sorrows for all the souls who are going to hell because there's no one to pray for them and because they reject her son. She still is saying, "Do whatever he tells you." That's Mary's most important words. Do whatever he tells you. And she tells that to us today. And so many people ignore her son. And it brings Mary great grief and sorrow, even to this day, that people ignore and mistreat and lie about her son. We as Catholics don't. We obey, because even in the Magnificat, Mary said, "All generations will call me blessed." And what church still calls Mary blessed? It's us, the Catholic Church. And now you see why I'm Catholic in regards to Mary, as in regards to the Eucharist yesterday and everywhere else. These are all the things my wife and I struggled through to come to grips with, and that's why we love being Catholic and we love Mary as well. So I'll quit for now, and we'll be back in a half an hour.
Well, do as Mary.